Hey, it's Fran again. I'm not in the lab though. I'm in the Northeast Philadelphia Airport because today I'm going to learn how to fly that plane. In the lab. Doing stuff. Making something. In the lab. That's what I'm doing. Working out. On the bench. In the lab. Yeah. Howard Cooper, the owner of this wonderful aircraft, you want to tell us something about your plane?
Sure, this is a Cessna 172. It was manufactured in 2002. The Cessna 172 is the most manufactured airplane in history of any type, including civilian and military aircraft. There's something like 50,000 have been manufactured since they first came online in 1956. Many, many pilots, you know, for many years have cut their teeth on this airplane. This one is the SP model, and it's got a little bigger engine than its older brothers and sisters. This is 180 horsepower fuel injected, four-cylinder, 360 cubic inch engine made by Lycoming.
Okay.
It's technically an IO360, one of the most popular small aircraft engines out there.
Entering into the cockpit. All right.
Okay, so as we get started, we follow our checklist and keep this with us at all times. Even if you know the pre-flight routine and the inspection routine, you want to keep it with you just to refer to. Make sure you've done everything that the manufacturer says you should do before you fly the airplane. As we're in the cockpit to get started, take out that control lock, keeps the control surfaces from whacking around in the wind.
Okay.
Turn the master switch on, give a visual check of our fuel quantity. We'll confirm that visually, but we can see that the gauges are indicating that the tanks are both full. And we'll get our flaps dropped. Those are coming down behind us. Give those an inspection before we take off.
Yep, there's the flaps.
And it's a good idea to do a quick check of our lighting system to make sure everything is working. So I'll put on some lights, make sure that they're functioning properly. So that's kind of everything we need to do inside for now. One more thing, put on the fuel selector to both tanks. We keep it parked in the left or right position. We always leave it on both for flying. Now I'm going to do a visual check of our lighting.
Okay.
So you can see up here that our taxi and landing lights are both operating. This is one of our strobe lights, and on the left wing we've got a red light. The solid white light is at the rear of the airplane. The rotating beacon is at the top. Those are all functioning. And as we move to the right wing, we should have one more flashing strobe, which we do, and a green light indicating the right wing. So now I've got all my lights are working properly. I can shut down the lighting to make sure we don't drain the battery.
Alrighty.
We do our walk around pre-flight inspection. We're going to start out right here at the spinner and the propeller. These are engine plugs. Keep this area plugged in. Actually, one of the biggest concerns we have are animals that could get in there.
Birds and squirrels,
yeah.
Yeah,
it's nice and warm after an engine has been run.
Oh, yeah.
So that's actually kind of can be a dangerous situation. So
yeah, exactly.
We're looking in there to see the remnants of a nest. Also give you a little tug here on our alternator belt. Make sure that's nice and snug. Air scoop is clear, not dirty. Inspection of our propeller.
Checking for nicks and stuff.
Big nicks, yeah. These are some surface stuff with, that's really the paint just has come off as dirt has hit the propeller.
Now you're checking for nicks because it's an aluminum prop, right?
And it's an aluminum prop, and if we had a big nick thicker than your thumbnail, that could indicate, you know, the possibility of metal fatigue,
yeah,
or fracture, anything like that. Then we call in the maintenance inspectors and have them take a look at it. But what we see here is sort of normal, which would be cleaned up with a coat of paint, which will eventually happen. As we're in the front of the airplane, we're gonna take a look at the nose gear. A lot of the problems that you find in an airplane are the cause of things that maybe a pilot didn't even know happened. Like a hard landing, didn't realize that something was broken. Maybe a vehicle drove too close and, you know, nicked a wingtip or something. So we're looking at things that might have been missed when the airplane was last flown. Looking for at least four fingers on the strut.
That's for checking the compression on
checking the compression, yeah, the hydrogen compression. And another thing you can do is give a little push to make sure that you've got a nice movement.
Oh, I see.
There you go.
Right. And that's checking because it's a gas-charged strut in the front.
And if it dropped right down and stayed down, that would be not good.
Not good.
Or if it's up really, really high, too much pressure, that wouldn't be good.
But okay.
We look for about four fingers. Static port. The static port provides static air pressure. It goes to our autopilot, actually.
So that's actually a pinhole that goes to the instrument panel.
Well, this one doesn't go to the panel. This one is a dedicated line that goes right to the autopilot. It has its own static source. We have another static port aft. That one goes to the instrument panel.
Ah, okay.
We'll get there. And now we're going to remove our pitot cover. This pitot tube, P-I-T-O-T, provides ram air. And this is the air collecting instrument that goes right to our airspeed indicator.
That's true airspeed.
It gives us our true airspeed, exactly.
Okay.
Looking at the...
Because unlike using like GPS for your airspeed... That
would be a ground speed.
Exactly, because the air is moving different to the ground.
Absolutely. So very often, if you have a strong headwind or tailwind, your airspeed is going to be different from your ground speed.
Right.
And we can see that on the GPS. That GPS gives us a pretty good idea of ground speed. Ground speed is very important, obviously, for how long it takes us to get someplace and how much fuel we're going to use.
Yeah, and it's very important to have the distinction between ground speed and airspeed.
Absolutely.
When you're in the air.
Especially when you're computing your fuel burn. Because the amount of time you're spending in the air is going to be based on your ground speed. And our fuel burn we use about 10 gallons an hour. So it's really on my ground speed, not, you know, in terms of calculating distance and time.
Okay.
Not airspeed. That's our stall horn. If my critical angle of attack exceeds the critical angle of attack, you're going to, just before that happens, you're going to hear this.
Oh, that's very interesting. So that's actually just an analog, just a whisk, like air past, like
it's got a
flute.
A reed in there.
Oh, really?
And so, as air pressure moves over this surface, it creates a suction. And if that suction is strong enough, you'll hear a whistle in the cabin, and that is our stall warning. Doesn't mean we've stalled, but it means we're getting close to that stall speed. That's a good thing to hear. You'll hear it when you land sometimes,
yeah,
because our landings are essentially...
You gotta stall. Yeah, you gotta stall to land.
So,
because if you're not stalling, you're still flying.
You're still flying. So we call it a controlled stall as we land the airplane. And these are our lights. We're looking for anything broken, damaged, the leading edge of the wing.
Typical bug stuff.
Always bugs. Looking at the underside of the wing. These here are access panels for inspections. And as we're back here, we can also take a look at the aileron.
Now, is this for electrostatic discharge?
Exactly. These are static wicks and lightning protection.
Yeah, it's actually just high voltage cable
with the
opening end. And so the little braid is there just to dissipate static charge from the wingtip.
And very effective. We've got a few of them around.
Thanks. So. Yeah.
This is our aileron, French word meaning little wing. Well, we all know about these are essentially looking at it as two triangles.
Yeah.
And every engineer knows that triangles are very strong. So these provide a lot of structural support. That's what they're built in for.
This is for rigidity in this plane.
Yes, exactly. Keeps it nice and stiff. It's got a rod right here, and that actuates the aileron.
Okay.
And you can see in the cabin, as we move the aileron, so move the yoke.
Yep. So we go, and that's our roll control.
That is our roll control. This is rolling the airplane on its longitudinal axis.
Right.
The axis that runs from the spinner straight throughout the tail. And we roll on that axis, and that is controlled by our ailerons.
Now these are the flaps.
These are the flaps. They allow us to fly slow for landing and descend. We descend without building up airspeed. So if you think of a car rolling down a hill, it's going to want to go faster. Well, airplanes want to go faster when they're descending too, so we need to slow that down. And these allow the airplane to fly, to descend without gaining, building airspeed. Flaps are primarily used for landing. Sometimes we use a special configuration of flaps for specialty takeoffs, but usually flaps are used when we land the airplane.
No, and it increases lift and drag,
absolutely.
Correct?
Absolutely. It increases lift and drag. It has an operating range, so you need to know at what airspeeds you can deploy flaps too fast, and now you're exceeding the manufacturer's specifications.
Right.
So don't want to do that. And what we look for here is a little bit of play in the flap, about a half inch or so. So what are we looking for is, like, is it flopping really big or is it locked in tight? Neither one of those are good. A little bit of play is perfect.
And that's just the mechanical play in the system for
absolutely.
The rods and everything.
Right? Absolutely.
Because this is all, you know, people don't realize this isn't fly-by-wire. This is all hand body control goes through rods and cables, and you're controlling the flight surfaces with your body strength.
Absolutely.
So it's
absolutely.
No.
Unlike the really
no
large
trickery.
Airliners, which, right, as you said, it's fly-by-wire, you're actually not moving the surface. You're talking to a computer, which is telling another computer to move the aileron or the flap, whatever it is. We're looking down at our left main. Mainly we're looking for damage. We can remove this shock at this point. And what are we looking for? Well, hydraulic fluid. That would be a bad thing to see if it was bleeding. Looking for any pitting or scarring on the disc. Anything that looks bent or broken wouldn't be good. And of course, making sure that there are no bald spots or, you know, any damage to the wheel. So we want to avoid putting a lateral pressure on the tire. We hopefully, when we land the airplane, our goal is to have the longitudinal axis, that axis that runs from the nose to the tail, parallel to the center line of the runway. So we're not what we call side loading. We're putting a load on the side of the tail. You don't want to do that. So moving back, this is our cargo door, which we'll keep shut. That's the other static port that I mentioned.
Okay.
This one goes right to our static pitot system and provides information to our altimeter, to our airspeed indicator, to our vertical speed indicator. GPS antenna while we're here. And our emergency locator transmitter antenna.
All right. What are the two up there, those two on the top of the wing?
Those are communications. Antennae?
So that's for communicating with the tower and
exactly.
other...
Two radios, two antenna. And while we're talking about antennas, we got two up here that are a little V-shape. And those are our VOR receivers. That's a ground-based navigation system. Not as popular these days because of GPS, but there's still... Many of them are still working, and you can use the GPS for navigation.
And they're in that sort of delta configuration for... So you can tell your position relative to a single beacon.
Exactly. And we have two VOR radios and two antenna.
And another one of those static
wick here
grades.
And two on the back on the elevator. This is our elevator. Elevator controls movement on our lateral axis. That's called pitch movement, bringing the nose down or up, or the tail down or up, is basically, which is the opposite. If the tail goes down, the nose comes up, tail goes up, the nose goes down. And right here we're looking for smooth movement, no binding. Looking underneath while I'm down here, we can look at our rudder cables, safety wire, and these go right to the foot pedals that make the rudder move to the left and right. Essentially swing the tail from the left to the right. As the tail moves this way, it moves the nose the other way.
So the tail is a rudder pedals are for yaw.
For yaw, that's the movement around the vertical axis. We call it yaw. So right, those are our three motions. We have roll, pitch, and yaw, and three control surfaces to work the airplane around those, to control those movements. And depending on what we're trying to do with the airplane, climb or descend, turn, we use a combination of pitch, roll, and yaw.
And again, we have that same ribbed structure.
Absolutely.
On the elevators.
Keeps them nice and stiff.
Also, too, the construction, this is all riveted. There's no screws,
no
fasteners. It's all like cold riveted together.
And yeah, all aluminum, all riveted together.
Now, this is interesting. This is an extra surface here. Is this a trim?
A secondary control. Yeah, it's called a trim tab. And it's got a little rod down here, you can see. A little castle nut. And a cotter pin, same up here, a little castle nut and cotter pin. Want to make sure those are in place. And the job of the trim tab is to relieve pressure on the yoke that, as it controls pitching movement. So if you find that you're constantly having to pull back or push down on the yoke to keep the airplane where you want it, you can turn a little wheel, move this panel up or down, and it'll relieve that pressure and more or less hold it where you want it. It's not a cruise control. It doesn't work that way. And you have to adjust trim temporarily, but it's certainly a very good device for avoiding constant pressure on the yoke, up or down. And there's only one. It's on the right side. And that's primarily because airplanes have natural left-turning tendencies.
That's because of the gyroscopic force of the prop, right?
A bunch of reasons.
Yeah.
Yeah, gyroscopic recession is one. It's got torque.
Engine torque.
Engine torque. Asymmetric disc loading, right? So that the propeller that's coming down on the right side, because of the angle of attack of the propeller, actually the right side produces more lift. And if you have more lift, of course, that lift is perpendicular to the propeller. It's going to want to turn the airplane to the left.
Right. So that's the natural tendency, is always to kind of pull to the left a little bit, or to turn to the left.
Absolutely. And so we have countermeasures for that. One of them is keeping the trim tab on this side. During our takeoff, we need a lot of right rudder to keep that airplane, which wants to turn, to the left.
Now, is that because you have the engine up all the way?
When you have high RPM and a high angle of attack, you have the most left-turning tendency.
Right.
And so, as that airplane wants to go to the left, we have to take measures to keep it, centered where we want it. Left-turning, in a left turn, we may not need much rudder because the airplane wants to turn to the left. In a right turn, we're certainly going to need to add some rudder to keep it coordinated. We'll talk more about that in flight.
Okay.
Quick look at our horizontal stabilizer, our vertical fin, make sure that there's no apparent damage. Looking at the fuselage. And as I'm at this point, I'm always going to come down here and take a quick look underneath. What I'm primarily looking for would be oil streaking.
Yeah.
Streaks of oil would mean I got an oil leak someplace. So I'd want to know if that was the case and where that oil was coming from and make sure that it wasn't, a serious problem. But our belly looks nice and clean. And now we're kind of mirroring what we did on the other side. We're going to give a quick look to the right gear, condition of the tire, brake, noting for any hydraulic fluid.
The other thing about because these are hydraulic brakes and there's two separate brakes and there's two separate brake controls, correct?
Yes.
So it's not like one pedal, one brake.
You've
got two separate brakes, one on either side.
And we steer the airplane through differential braking.
Right. So, and that's done through the same pedals as the rudder control.
Yeah, they have two functions. The top part of the pedal is our brake. The bottom part controls the rudder. So foot placement is very important. Our right flap. Tied through there. There's one on the bottom back half part of the airplane, and
also on the other wing.
Yeah.
And again,
general inspection, and that takes us back to the propeller and the spinner, which is where we started. So we've done a complete walk around, looking at all parts of the airplane. In terms of structurally, I think we're in good shape. The last thing we're going to do is check liquids. We're going to check fuel for contamination, and we're going to check quantity of oil. Okay, you can do these in any order. I like to do them all at once. So what we're doing now is we're checking for fuel contamination. The primary contaminant we're looking for is water. And if you were to see water, it would look like air bubbles at the bottom of the fuel. So we're going to take samples through these sub-drains. There are 5 sub-drains on each wing and 3 under the belly of the airplane, for a total of 13. That's a bit unique to this airplane. Most airplanes do not have quite so many.
Taxiing there.
We'll check these. And these are looking good. And we'll get the 5 under this wing.
That's just got a pin on it that you stick up into like a little valve type thing.
Exactly.
And it just kind of drains into the cup.
And people so often ask, well, what do you do if you do find contaminant or water? Well, you keep draining until you don't get any more and discard it. Because this is nice and contaminant free, and the fuel we use, 100 low lead, has that bluish kind of turquoise tint.
Yeah.
Lets us know what kind of fuel it is.
100 octane.
100 low lead.
Okay. Now, there is a little bit of lead in it.
Well, all low lead has a little bit of lead, but...
it's not like unleaded gasoline.
No. But it is made for aircraft.
Right.
And I think race cars also use these.
Well, the high octane, then, this is because as they increase the octane rating in fuel, it retards the ability of the fuel to, like, spontaneously combust. So you want that reliability in the ignition...
Hyper stable. Absolutely. And... While there are airplanes that have aircraft that can burn auto fuel, this is not one of them. So we use aircraft fuel, a little more expensive than auto fuel.
Yeah, I would think.
So now that we see this is okay and I've got a screen on the top to filter anything, I can reintroduce this into the fuel tank.
All right.
And it'll also give me a chance to visually inspect my fuel tank. We always visually inspect the fuel. It would be unfortunate if your fuel gauge was broken, and it's such an easy way to tell, right? All I gotta do is look and I can see the fuel. So I can see that the fuel is topped off all the way up to the top. Last thing we're gonna check is the oil. And this is like in your car, dipstick. I'm going to bring it down and take a look. And you can see that the oil is a little bit more than 6. And our range, our limit is from 6 to 8. So more than 6 is good. If it would get a little below, we just add some.
Also the color, you're looking at the color for any engine.
Nice and clean. Yeah, it hasn't been that long since an oil change. You put this back on. Always tell students, don't tighten it too much. It doesn't hold the wings on. So we've checked our liquids, fuel and oil, done a complete walk around of the airplane. I'm convinced that the airplane meets all the requirements, and we're ready to go.
All right.
So I'm going to do a prime first. Turn on the, got the master switch on. 1, 2, 3, that's our prime.
That's fuel prime.
Fuel prime, mixture goes to cutoff and crack the throttle. Now we're ready to start the engine. Much better. Clear! Feet on the brake, hands over here, and... Good. So our oil temperature and oil pressure are good. All right, you can close your window.
It's so loud. You can't even hear. Well, now, you hear.
Now you can hear. And whenever, when you can hear yourself, I can hear you.
Okay.
And it's just loading up.
Northeast Ground Cherokee 3945 Romeo, clear runway 24 Charlie, taxi back hangars.
Cherokee 3945 Romeo, Northeast Ground, taxi to parking via Charlie, Alpha 1 Bravo, cross runway 33 at the approach end.
Charlie, Alpha 1 Bravo, cleared to cross 33 at the approach end, Cherokee 3945 Romeo.
Putting in our position and what are you entering into?
So we're going to put in our, for now, our flight. Let's see.
Entering our flight plan.
There we go.
All right. You're basically telling me where we're going to be going to, or?
Yeah, so we'll put in, I thought I saved it, but it didn't save. So, going to put in KI.
2 Golf Juliet, cross runway 24 at Alpha, hold short runway 33 at Lima.
Cross 24 at Alpha, hold short at 33 at Lima, 442 Golf Juliet.
ILG is the identifier. We're putting that KILB, enter. And
that's for Wilmington Airport?
Yep. Okay. And we'll listen to our weather.
Formation Foxtrot.
Beach at 2 Golf Juliet, cross runway 33 at Lima.
Northeast Philadelphia Airport, information Foxtrot. 1554 Zulu, wind 220 at 9. Sky clear below 12000. Temperature 18. Viewpoint minus 2. Altimeter 3039. Visual approach runway 24 in use.
Okay.
That was the airman. ILS runway 24 localizer and glide path out of service. Runway 6.
That's a continuous loop for the airport?
It is. And information Foxtrot to give a letter to each one. We're going to put in our 30.39 on our altimeter setting. 30.39 inches. And we'll do it here. 0.39 inches. There, and we'll do it here. Why not?
That's setting our ground level where we are right now.
Exactly.
Because a lot of people would think that that's, you know, that's not universal.
No, it's constantly changing, and you'll see that they constantly give us new information below. So now we'll give them a call and tell them we're ready to go, basically. All radio calls, who I'm calling, who I am, where I am, and what I want. That's the basic rule. So we'll give them a call on ground frequency 121.7. Northeast Philadelphia ground, good afternoon, Cessna 5286 Lima's at the city ramp, ready to taxi with Foxtrot. We're going to be heading south and west down to Newcastle, Delaware.
Cessna 5286 Lima, northeast ground, runway 24 at Juliet, intersection departure. Taxi via Bravo, Alpha, Golf, Juliet, cross runway 33 at Golf.
All right, Cessna 5286 Lima is going to be going to runway 24 Juliet, departure Bravo, Alpha, Golf, Juliet, and crossing 33 Golf. Just to amend that, we're actually we're at the city ramp, so can I take Alpha 2, is that possible?
Alpha 2 is approved.
Alpha 2 to Alpha for 5286 Lima. All right. So we've got our taxi instructions, and we repeat them back. They're all on the same page. As we're taxiing.
Two Golf Juliet, have you going momentarily? There's a helicopter landing Lima 3.
Roger that.
Now you're just adjusting the mix there.
So we're going to lean it out a little bit. Yeah, I foul up the spark plugs, you know, during our taxi.
And that's something you're constantly going to adjust with altitude, correct? With oxygen.
Well, not at lower altitudes. The manufacturer recommends we start adjusting it after 3,000 feet above sea. So if we are above that, yeah, then we will. Oh. All right, so she told us Alpha 2. That's this taxiway here. Looking at our turn, checking that my turn coordinator is working properly, and it is. It dips into the turn and then rights itself.
Right.
And you'll see that again as we make this left turn. There it goes. And while I'm here, we'll do a quick brake check as well. My brakes are good. And a quick scan shows us that our engine instruments are looking good, our flight instruments are looking good. We're seeing about zero on our VSI. That's correct, because we're not climbing or descending. About 1,000 RPM. We put in our field barometric pressure, and that's giving me a good approximation of our current field elevation, which is about 120 feet. So, yeah, everything is looking the way it's supposed to look. And she told me to cross runway 33 at Gulf, so I've got to be looking for that.
Ground helicopter at her 39 Sierra Hotel.
That'll be a right turn.
Helicopter 9 Sierra Hotel, if you could sidestep into Lima 3 intersection, we got a jet going full length for runway 24, and I'll have you going momentarily.
Affirmative, we'll sidestep to Lima 3.
H-Jet 2, Golf Juliet, continue taxiing. That helicopter is going to sidestep into the Lima 3 intersection, or correction, Lima 3 taxiway.
Roger, we'll continue Lima 3, we'll continue Lima, 442 Golf Juliet.
And if you can see that sign coming up there, with a little right angle, that's a directional sign, that's telling me the taxiway Golf is a right turn, so I'm going to get ready to do that. And as a courtesy, I'll let the tower know.
Helicopter 9 at your hotel behind the beach jet taxiing on Lima. Hull work on Lima is approved.
Work on Lima is approved. I'm good.
And 86 Lima's crossing 33 Echo.
So 86 Lima, roger.
It's always a good idea to confirm.
Yeah, just to make sure.
And she told us Gulf to Juliet, so that sign right there, it's got a black background and a yellow G. That means we are currently on taxiway Gulf.
Right.
And Juliet's going to be coming up. And
right now, you're steering with your brakes, correct?
I am steering with my feet. That's correct.
Right. Yeah, because people don't realize there's no steering wheel on a plane, so...
Well, that's not going to do anything,
yeah,
correct.
Yeah, because to turn, you got to put a foot down on the brake on the side you want to turn
and
to.
We want to keep our feet off the brakes. We want to ride them, except when we need a little tap to get us on a turn. So coming up here, here's our left turn on Juliet. And when we come up here, I'm just going to give a little tap with my left toe, and that's going to get me started on a nice, hopefully gentle left turn right about here. So a little bit of pressure, and that's it.
Oh, so just a light touch.
Light touch. Very little. And up here, we're going to do our run-up, our engine run-up. That's next. Oops. And we're going to come up.
Another
So our run-up is a last-minute stress of the engine. And we're going to come up here and more or less point it into the wind, which will be this way.
Juliet intersection departure, taxi via Alpha 3, Alpha Golf Juliet.
All right, we're going to leave it here and do a quick run-up. So brakes are set, seat belts, everybody check, door, give it a tap, windows locked, good, flight controls. I'm going to go all the way around the box, make sure that I've got complete freedom of movement on my flight controls. Those are good. And waggle the rudder. That's working good too. And we got our instruments. I do a scan of my panel. Everything is looking in the green, as we say. Everything is good. Mixture is full rich now. Fuel selector confirming it's on both. We're not using our autopilot. Now I'm going to put some RPM in here, stress the engine. Going to come up to 1,800 RPM right there, and now I'm going to do my mag check. So we're going to go right, look for the little drop in RPM, back to both, left, we can talk about this later, back to both. Good, everything's in the green. I'm going to quick do a ammeter check. There goes my drop in voltage because I turned it off, and comes right back up. That means it's moving. And the last thing I'm going to do is pull it all the way out to idle and make sure the engine doesn't quit. So it's a lot of stuff happening quickly in that check. Yeah. And we'll adjust the friction here. We'll set our frequencies over to tower frequency. While I'm here, I can put in the frequency for Philadelphia approach. I'm ready to go. Just one less thing to do. Our flaps are already up. Transponder is in the correct position. Now I'm going to pull up here and let them know we're ready to go.
All right.
Lots of stuff going on.
Yeah. There's a lot to do in the run-up to takeoff.
All right, so we're going to give them a call. Northeast Tower, good afternoon. Cessna 5286 Lima, ready to go. Juliet intersection, runway 24. And we're heading southwest to Wilmington.
November 769, frequency change approved.
Frequency change approved, 769, thank you.
PCA 2 Golf Juliet, contact for departure, safe flight.
Over departure, 2 Golf Juliet.
Last call, Northeast Tower, unanswered, say again.
5286 Lima, Juliet 24, departure to the southwest, ready to go.
Cessna 5286 Lima, Northeast Tower, hold for wake turbulence.
86 Lima is holding for wake turbulence. Jet just took off. Now we're going to, give me a minute.
Station 641 Mike Sierra, Northeast Tower, runway 24, clear to land, wind 220 at 11, safe parking.
Atlantic, and we're clear to land, 24 Mike Sierra.
So right now we're waiting for traffic, right?
No, we're waiting for the turbulence to clean up. He's going to let us go. I think, I think that other guy's far enough that we have time to get out, but.
Just the jet turbulence from the landing.
I'd like to space him out a little bit.
Okay.
But. He's in charge, so I gotta wait for him.
Not a Lear.
Citation. Cessna Citation.
Oh, it's a Cessna.
Yep. They make a lot of nice jets.
Citation 1, Mike Sierra, able left turn, Charlie.
Yes, sir.
1, Mike Sierra, Roger, Charlie, ground point 7.
Ground point 7 is Charlie, Mike Sierra.
Cessna 5286 Lima, runway 24 Juliet, clear takeoff. Encore true, wind 230 at 11.
5286 Lima is clear for takeoff, runway 24 Juliet.
on course, and we'll be looking to change over to Philadelphia approach. All right, so I'm looking, nobody's there. Want to make sure nobody's landing, right?
Yeah.
We're going to steer out to the center line. Nice and clear in front of us. Good. Now my feet go, my heels go on the floor. I don't want to hit the brakes now. I'm going to increase the throttle all the way in. Now I've got that right rudder going in to keep us turning to, from the left, right? All that left turning tendency. Keep it on the center line. I'm looking for 60. And when we hit 60 knots, I'm just going to lift the nose. And the airplane flies itself right off the ground. I'm going to try and keep it over the center line.
Really climbing.
We're climbing at about 1,000 feet per minute. Excellent, excellent climbing capabilities.
This has really got some chutzpah.
Oh yeah. She's a beaut. Flies great. And that's pretty much our heading, is straight ahead.
Yep.
But we're not sure where they're going to send us.
Feeling a little bit of instability in the air there.
Well, it's just some, a little bit of turbulence is very normal.
Because we got heat rising.
And that's what we're feeling.
Yeah. Now, is that going to be, you feel the turbulence closer to the ground where the heat is coming off, or it varies?
Yes, but it varies.
It varies.
See, feel it all over the place.
Now I got my ears popping, so
we're moving.
We have the altimeter, we just crossed 1,000 feet.
1,000 feet above sea level.
Sea level, right. And where did we start out?
About 120 feet.
Okay. Wow. Visibility is like hundreds of miles.
He's going to need to give me a handoff real soon. Over to Philadelphia Approach. Thanks for your help. 5286 Lima. Philadelphia Approach, that's the 5286 Lima.
All right, everybody else stand by. Terra 58, Billy.
Terra 58, negative.
Okay, so we're still in the room. Are you going over towards Robbins? So how did they clear you out?
They cleared us from Yardley to GXU, Terra 58.
0 Fox Trot Lima, turn left heading 210, intercept the final approach course, runway 24 for training.
210, then intercept the final approach course, 0 Fox Lima.
Okay, Terra 58, going to contact McGuire, 126.47.
126.47, Terra 58.
0 Fox Trot Lima, descend to maintain 2000.
Descend to maintain 2000, 0 Fox Lima.
Who else called me?
Cessna 5286 Lima.
Okay, stand by. Your VFR, stand by outside the Bravo. Let me clean some stuff up. If you won't come back to you, just stand by.
Stand by outside the Bravo, 86 Lima.
You clear for the GPS Zulu 24 into Trenton Airport. Go ahead and contact Trenton Tower.
All right, we'll go over to Tower, 2-0 Fox Lima.
And you're clear for the approach, sir.
Clear for the approach, 2-0 Fox Lima.
So we approach connection 211 November.
511, what do you need? I've already cleared you into through the Bravo for Martin State. You're clear, sir. Number 76 Mike, you can contact Allentown Approach on 124.45.
2445, 76 Mike.
All right, the first one that I told to stand by. Go ahead.
Cessna 5286 Lima is southwest of PNE, 2,000 feet, like flight following to Wilmington ILG at 4,500.
What's your call sign?
5286 Lima.
5286 Lima. Okay, 5286 Lima. Well, 0270 ident and maintain VFR.
Say again on the ident, please.
0270?
027, 5286 Lima.
Wing 13, Philadelphia 124.35.
2435, wing 13 again.
Good day. 5286 Lima, radar contact, Philadelphia's altimeter is 3037. And we're going to Wilmington Airport. So let's fly the heading for now to 270, vectors around through South Bend, then we'll get you on course on the other side for Wilmington.
Roger, 5286 Lima, 270 on the heading, and what is the altitude you're preferring, please?
What altitude would you like? You're going to go, are you familiar with the Roxborough antennas?
Negative.
Okay, 5, 8, 6, Lima, maintain 3,000.
3,000, 5, 2, 8, 6, Lima. Okay.
Okay, who else is waiting?
So she's giving us a heading of 270, 3,000 feet, and that's where we're going to go.
All right.
Going off the deck of Saskers, he headed November 13, overhead PNE.
It gets busy.
11 November, fog 0240, and I did.
So 240 flash 211 November.
Philadelphia Pro, Skyhawk 1323 X-ray with you, 3500.
Number 1323 X-ray with you, destination.
Tango Tango November.
Number 1323 X-ray, maintain VFR as you proceed inbound for trend, report any course of altitude deviation.
Maintain VFR, report any altitude deviation, 1323 X-ray.
And 11 November is 0240
November.
Number 11 November, radar contact, Philadelphia altimeter 3037. Very stable. Where are you going?
Yes. The air is a lot cleaner up here.
November 13? Okay, where is that?
At Bloomsbury.
Okay.
Philly approach 0321 Gulf here. Good morning, Cirrus 321 Golf here. I'm off Wingfield, Lima Oscar Mike at 1,200 feet. I'm just looking to see if I can get a quick Bravo clearance and a orbit of Center City, Philadelphia.
Of Center City?
Center City, Philadelphia, correct.
Center City, not right now, no you can't. What altitude did you want to do with that?
I'll take whatever you can get me if you allow it.
Yeah, that's a long shot. I'll tell you what, I'll give you a squawk, I'll vector you out, bring you in, I can. You can squawk 0215 and I did for me.
Okay, so 0321 Golf here, 0215 ident, and I'll look for your vectors out and then back in. I really appreciate it. Thank you.
So number 5286 Lima, if I didn't tell you, you are cleared into the Bravo, just stay on that heading until further advised.
5286 Lima, thanks for that. Appreciate it.
So number 44511, contact Philadelphia.
I was thinking about that.
Yeah.
Didn't actually say it.
You'll be fine.
But...
Number 321 Golf Sierra, I didn't.
So we're staying at 3,000 feet and heading west.
We're doing about 120 knots.
Yes, we are.
Alright.
Now, ground speed.
I'll bring you back around. How long do you need to do?
Alright, the GPS.
What is it that we're trying to do?
So,
I'm just looking to do two quick orbits of Philadelphia, and I'll be in and out of here.
107.
You're familiar with the Roxborough antennas?
That's affirmative.
All right, 3,000 for now. Give me a minute, I'll bring you in.
That's okay, actual ground speed by GPS.
Correct.
That's our actual airspeed.
That is correct.
All right. I noticed that we were climbing, we were doing about 80, 90 knots.
November 86 Lima, go ahead and contact the
Philadelphia
124.35, 2435. Over 2435 for 86 Lima.
Mile 4785, turn left our ditch.
And Philadelphia approach, Cessna 5286 Lima with you, level 3000.
Mile 4947, climbing in 13000.
I maintain 13000, still not to exceed 250 feet, Muffer Neon 47.
Yes, sir, thanks. November 5286 Lima, Philadelphia, altimeter 3037.
3037,
86 Lima. Today, approach number 44511,
level 4500.
November 4511, Philadelphia, altimeter
3037.
We're good?
All right.
P-Mile 4921, turn right direct Medina.
Direct Medina, P-Mile 4921.
November Niner, Charlie Victor, did you have the Maisie or the Jake? Okay, thanks.
Okay. Gonna get a little noisy.
Mercer, I'll give you 70 clearance here shortly.
Three back, hold short.
Frontier 800, you said you want the Yankee? Frontier 800, so.
Confirmation Tango 1651.
Do you want the Yankee or the Blue?
0 at 11 visibility, 10 Sky.
Frontier 800, proceed our Tama. Frontier 800, proceed our Tama and contact Philly 123.8. American 1107, contact New York Center, 135.45.
135.45, American 1107.
It's over there somewhere.
49.47, yeah. Normal speed in contact New York Center, 124.62.
Are we going to be doing a turn?
Normal speed, 124.62.
Eventually.
Yeah, eventually.
Departure Blue Streak 52.
So we're going a little west.
0 Zulu Bravo, clear visual parking sensor count. Blue Streak 5290, Philadelphia departure radar contact, climbing chain 10,000.
10,000 for Blue Streak 5290.
November 21056, proceed direct trend.
056 on the trend, thanks.
November 0 Zulu Bravo, don't forget stand sky, fire radar service terminated, finger chain approved, good night. 0 Zulu Bravo, thanks, squawk maintain VFR, finger chain approved, have a good day. Who's checking in? Blue Streak 5290, turn right direct Medina.
Right direct Medina, Blue Streak 5290.
November 21056, contact Philly 123.8.
123.8056.
Exit at 769, descend via J3.
Are you adjusting the trim?
It's correct.
Now, is that,
good morning, or good morning.
Does that have to do with the center of gravity or center of mass?
2 mile 4046, Philadelphia departure, radar contact, climb and maintain 10,000.
That really doesn't move much.
Yeah, a little bumpy. Yeah.
I'll pull a little airspeed out.
Yeah.
Slow down a little bit.
P-Mile 4785, contact New York Center, 118.
Looks like when we go over the subdivisions and such, there's more heat rising off the cement.
That is true.
And we get over the wooded area, it's cooling down a bit. Now the turn?
Let's keep us on course.
All right.
Slow this down a little bit.
They're pretty much heading due west right now.
And we have wind right in our face. That's a wind vector.
Oh, is it on, that's wind.
That little arrow.
Oh, that's
good. Coming right at us.
Oh, that's the wind right there.
Yeah.
So we're pretty much going right into the wind.
Coming home will be faster.
Right. That's the difference between our ground speed and our air speed.
Absolutely.
Yeah. 96
ground speed and
107.
45 speed bond, 4921 today. American 2769, Philadelphia departure, contact climbing chain 12.
Wow. That's just beautiful.
What's up, request 589, contact New York approach 132.8.
132.8, what's up, 589.
P-Mile 4046, turn right direct Stone. Right direct Stone, P-Mile 4846.
Departure cap 4628 to 1545, heading 245.
Forget 4628, Philadelphia departure, radar contact, climb and maintain 10,000.
Climb maintain 10,000, care 4628.
That's really something.
November 9 or Charlie Victor, thanks. Descend via the Maisie 2. Blue Streak 5290, contact New York Center 135.45.
3545, do whatever you need to do.
Exit at 769, contact New York approach 132.8. American 2769, turn left direct ditch. Exit at 769, contact New York approach 132.8.
Is our altitude around 3,100 feet-ish.
Yeah, standard. Close to 3,000.
Earth turn indicator. Turn a little bit.
Yeah, move this around. Got to keep correcting. Constantly correcting.
Yeah.
Here's the
wind
our heading. Yep.
The wind is pushing us
a little bit. Yep. So
a little bit port,
approach
right?
Hello, Legacy XL Alpha Charlie Oscar Sierra.
Yes, there's a little bit of a left.
Descending 13,000 with whiskey.
Right to left.
Alpha Charlie Oscar Sierra, Philadelphia, altimeter 3036.
3036 XL Alpha Charlie Oscar Sierra.
P-mile 4913, turn right direct pots down.
Right direct pots down, P-mile 4913.
Oh. Looks like we lost that GoPro. Oh, we lost both of them.
It's off.
Good afternoon, P-MOP 4936. There's 1.3 climbing 5, heading 265.
P-MOP 4936, set off the departure radar contact. Climbing maintain 10,000.
10,000, P-MOP 4936.
Cooper Cat 4628, turn right direct stone.
Turn right direct stone, be careful. 4628.
The other one fell off, it's in the back somewhere. I gotta fish around for it.
I'm fine. Oops.
Keep on 4846, looking for higher if possible. Yep, the center just took the hand off there, sir. So P-MOP 4046, contact New York Center 135.45, good day. 35.45, thanks. P-MOP 4846. P-MOP 4936, turn right direct Medina.
Right direct Modena, P-MOP 4936.
P-MOP 4913, climb and maintain 13,000.
13,000, P-MOP 4913.
X-ray Alpha, Charlie Oscar Sierra, the 7B of the Jake 3.
You're going to fly off. Oh, you found it. Oh, hey. Oh, that way.
Archer, good afternoon. Right. Fairway 215 out of coming up 1,000, climb at 5,000, heading 265.
Spirit 215, fell off the departure radar contact, climb and maintain 10,000.
Climb 10,000, fairway 250.
American 2769, contact New York Center 118.97. Oh. Yeah.
I think it's the difference in air pressure.
Might have. Not impossible.
Ah, it fell off again.
Try wetting it.
I don't have anything to wet it with. That
sometimes makes a better seal.
Hang on.
Spearwing 215, turn right direct Medina.
Right turn direct Medina, spearwing 215.
I have the perfect stuff.
There you go.
Yeah, good. Perfect sealer, a little bit of hand lotion.
That should work.
It'll just be...
Just a teeny little bit to give you a nice seal. Oh. Hopefully he's going to give me a call soon. Tell me, give me a turn.
Alright, try this again.
Oh, that one didn't fall off. That's good.
See how that goes.
Pickard 4628, contact New York Center, 135.45.
Airport's over there.
3545 for New York, Pickard 4628, 0.
P-MOP 4936, contact New York Center, 132.2.
32-2, good day, P-MOP 4936.
That's a 1916 out of 245. American 1916, set off the departure radar contact, climb and maintain 10,000. Climb and maintain 10,000, American 1916. Spearwing 215, contact New York Center, 135.45.
135.45, Spearwing 215.
P-MOP 4913, contact New York Center, 124.62.
124.62, P-MOP 4913, good day.
November 909, Charlie Victor, contact New York, approach 132.8, could I? Look at 1579, thought I was departure, radar contact, climb 18, 12.
I think that got it.
Alright.
I'm saying that and it'll fall off again, but I think we got it. Right.
American 1916, turn right direct Medina.
Right direct Medina, American 1916.
Coming up on Medina. There it is. There's the VOR station. I'm guessing he's...
All right, there, we just flew over it.
Yeah.
Is that it there? Yep.
Quick guard 5879, turn left right ditch.
At Philadelphia approach, 5286 Lima.
November 5286 Lima, proceed on course to Wilmington.
Left on course to Wilmington, 5286 Lima. He forgot.
Alright, doing a 2 minute turn to the left.
American 1532 Philadelphia departure, radar contact, climb and maintain 1-2000.
Wilmington Tower information, Tango 1651 Zulu, wind 250 at 1-1, visibility 1-0, sky clear, temperature 2-0, dew point minus 3, altimeter 3-0, tree niner. Expect GPS for visual approach, runway 27 in use. Notice is air.
Hey.
Yeah, there'll be some editing and post with the technical difficulties. It'll be a slightly shorter...
I hope so.
A slightly shorter video.
Well, we're only 12 miles. He's got to give me over to them eventually.
American 1916, contact New York Center 135.45.
45, American 19.
I got visual in the airport.
Yep. It's right in front of us.
Yep, indeed.
Philadelphia approach, 86 Lima, Scott Wilmington, insight.
5286 Lima, Roger, VFR, descent approved, radar services are terminated. You can keep your code. Wilmington Tower uses 126.0. Good day.
Roger, we'll keep the code. We're actually doing a touch and go and coming back, so you'll hear us on the way back.
All right, talk to you soon.
Okay.
American 1532, turn left for TV.
All right, so you just told him what we're going to do.
Yeah, and I'm going to call Wilmington now. Well, Newcastle Tower, afternoon, Cessna 5286 Lima is 10 miles to the north, inbound for the option with Tango.
Cessna 5286 Lima, Wilmington Tower, wind 24013, gust 21, enter right base, runway 27, report 3 miles out in the base.
That'll be a right base for 27, 3 miles out, 5286 Lima. All right, so right base for 27, okay.
Yeah, 86 Lima, are you a Skyline or a Skyhawk?
That's a Cessna Skyhawk, 86 Lima.
Roger, thank you.
He said right base, that means we're going to come by on the right side and come around.
So I'm going to be at basically 90 degrees to the runway. So 27 minus 90.
Okay, got it.
About 180 on the heading.
And for the people watching, we're going to do a what they call a touch and go.
Touch and go.
It means you land and then you don't stop.
Yeah.
Gonna get the wheels down and then we're gonna take off right again.
We'll come down. A 1,000 feet is our traffic pattern altitude. And we are pretty much on a nice right base right now.
Wilmington Tower, Delaware Trooper 5.
Delaware Trooper 5, Wilmington Tower.
Runway 215 is just outside Hayden, like to do the practice ILS runway 1 if available.
215, roger, report Hayden inbound, maintain VFR at all times.
Roger, 215, report Hayden inbound.
All right. Yeah, ready to land. Well, mixture is full rich, tanks on both. Those are our key pieces of information. And we're trying to hold our southerly heading. And we make a right turn to the runway. Airport's over there, so, and he said about 3 miles out, so we got a little bit of time. And our, looking pretty good on our altitude, don't want to get too low. We are about perpendicular, so that's not our runway. There's another runway we're going to be looking for. A little bit bumpy.
It's actually not that bad. I mean, I expect it to be a little worse.
Yeah, it'll be a little crazy on the touch and go, but that's okay.
So for this maneuver, we're actually going to go a little bit past the airport, do a turn.
Well, we'll make just one right turn line up.
One right turn. So we're 90 degrees to the runway right now.
Yeah, but there's one runway out there, that's not ours.
Yeah.
We're a different one.
Yeah, well, yeah, I see.
Yeah, we'll put some lights on, let them help have them see us easier.
All right,
here's our traffic pattern altitude. We're good with that for now.
1,000 feet?
Yeah, about 1,000 feet. Slowing it down. Gonna get in a notch of flaps as soon as we get below 110 knots. Get our first notch of flaps in right there. There's a notch. That'll help slow us down. And we'll start our descent. Little bit of a descent. Now we're just going to be working pitch and power. So it's our pitch that controls our airspeed, and power controls our descent. That makes sense. We pull up to slow down. If we want to come down faster, we pull out power. If we want to come down slower, we add power. There's our runway. We should be at about 90 degrees to it. Yep, and we're coming down. 5286 is about 3 miles out on a right base.
Runway 6 Lima, roger. Runway 27, clear to land.
Clear for 87. We'd like the option touch and go. We'll be heading back to Northeast Philadelphia.
Runway 6 Lima, roger. Runway 27, clear for the option. On course approved.
Clear for the option, 86 Lima on course. All right, let's get another notch of flaps, and I'm going to leave it at 20 degrees. A little wind. You see our touchdown point? Right over there.
Yep.
And if all this works out, when we make that right turn, our heading should be 270, which is... I know, you know, now I'm just balancing pitch and power to get me where I want to be. That's about right. I want to be about 500 feet over the field as I turn final. There's my aiming point. There we go. We'll start our turn.
And there's the runway.
There's the runway.
That was perfect.
Wind check.
Wind 240 at 8, gust 15.
Alright. So we're looking really good.
We're almost right into the wind.
Yep, that helps.
Yeah.
A little bit of a crosswind. We'll compensate for that.
Yeah, it's coming a little from the right, right? The
Yep.
Okay.
240, so a little bit off.
bringing in a little extra speed with the wind.
Tower, Trooper 5.
Trooper 5, Wilmington Tower.
Sir, we're going to do a 180 and just reestablish our inbound heading. And we'll call Hayden inbound.
Trooper 5, roger.
So, you can just let it settle in. Don't rush it. Don't push it down. Sort of let it settle.
And that's the stall. Whistle there.
There you go. All right, now I'm going to take my flaps up.
Right.
Take my time.
We're on the ground. Very temporarily. All right.
There's my 60, and I'm ready to go. And we'll get ready here.
We are climbing. And you just loaded in Northeast Philadelphia.
I did indeed.
Right. That was a touch and go.
That was it.
So I heard the stall whistle just before we hit the
As it should. That's exactly what we want to hear.
And so just it was just a very gentle touch.
I'm going to start our slow turn to, here we go. And we can start a nice slow turn to our heading of 062.
Now I guess this goes in reverse. You'll have to talk to Philadelphia again to...
He'll switch us over just like we did coming here.
I see.
Looks like our camera's doing better.
We're still going. Still good.
Cessna
86
Lima, approved to change
approved
flight following
was 119.75. 119.75. Thanks for your help today, 86 Lima. Philadelphia approach, good afternoon, Cessna 5286 Lima.
Cessna 5286 Lima, fully approach IDAM. Your radar contact a mile north of Wilmington. What's your destination this time?
Northeast Philadelphia. Go back home.
All right, November 5286 Lima. You're closer to Philly Bravo airspace at or above 3,000, and for now heading 010 just to keep you away from the departures.
All right, 010 at 3,000, 5286 Lima. Thank you. Thank you much.
604 Philly approach normal speed.
All right, 010, so a little to our left, 3,000 feet.
Exit at 604, you have traffic to your 11 moving to 12 o'clock and about 7 miles northbound, 7 for 9,000
there
is the number.
2,000 feet for 3,000. She's cleared me through the Bravo. So everything happened quickly but efficiently. And now we're flying a heading of 010, which is mostly north.
And exit 604, roger.
We make these changes gradually, slowly, there's nothing. You know, imminent, you know, we always make our corrections deliberately but slowly and under control.
Brickyard 4537, the traffic's passing behind you now, not a factor.
There we go, so there's 010, we're going to bug that heading.
Exit at 604,
keep my climb coming.
It'll be climbing through your altitude.
Hold this heading.
4829, contact New York Center, 118.97.
She's
going
to send us up north and then a right turn to the airport.
4829.
Not bad.
Pretty smooth. Very smooth when you get over 2,000 feet.
Yeah, it's smoothed out. Here we go.
American 1663 out of 1.6 for 5,000.
American 1663, Philly departure, radar contact, climb maintain 1-2-12,000.
Climb maintain 1-2-12,000, American 1663.
And there's 2,800 for 3,000. And we're close to 010. So what I do is I pick a point You can see way out in the distance, you've got the
Limerick Tower.
Seems to be about our heading. So just point there.
Yeah.
It's an easy way to do it. Level out at 3,000 feet. Let our airspeed build up as we stop climbing. We're going to increase, right? Propeller will be turning faster because it's not working as hard. And we'll pull out some power as we accelerate. Try to hold that heading at altitude. So your first lessons as a student pilot would be to work on holding that heading at altitude, which is a lot harder than it sounds. Air is constantly moving, so we're constantly correcting.
1897,
American 2028, g'day.
Who's looking for a clearance to PBI?
Oh.
Are you on the ground?
Busy.
All right, give me a second.
Hi.
PMO 4901, Philly departure radar contact, climb maintain 12,000. American 1663, can proceed direct to you.
Direct to you, American 1663.
Brickyard 4537, contact New York Center 124.62. November 550, Zulu Bravo, maintain VFR and squawk 1620. Piedmont 4901, turn right, direct Pottstown.
I don't know why that keeps resetting. Something.
November 550,
maybe vibration.
Your radar contact position is reported. I'm showing you out of 3,400. You're cleared to Papa Bravo India via proceed direct Woodstown. Oscar Delta has been as previously cleared, or then as filed. Sorry.
This went out again.
Yeah, there's a something came on.
November 550 Zulu Bravo, climb maintain 10,000.
It's not the battery, I don't think.
I don't know. I'm gonna check here.
8086 kilo Philly approach altimeter is 3035.
That's a low battery, I think.
I have your request, just so you know, I'll have to take you around south of the field and back to you for the approach. American 1663, contact the Washington Center, 132.05.
13205, American 1663.
Some editing magic. Magic. Went out again?
Went out again.
Do you have another battery?
No. 550 Zulu Bravo. You can proceed direct TB. Tango Echo Bravo Echo Echo.
I had one.
It's up to you. Either way, there's IFR traffic you're going to follow to the field, so I'm going to have to take you south.
I don't have it. I thought I...
I'm just going to overfly the field and then vector you to final. It's not really going to be a big deal. Piedmont 4901, climb maintain 13,000. November 5286 Lima, fly heading 060.
060, 5286 Lima.
Battery's good.
That's a weird thing. Keeps shutting down.
Helicopter 2 November Juliet Philly approach altimeter is 3035.
Oh no, the battery's going down. Yeah. It's,
2 November Juliet, Roger.
Looks like this just has a bad battery. It's just dropping off as I start it. It could be the heat. It's in the sun. It could be overheating.
Definite possibility. I've had this experience, by the way, that it does that. It just shuts down.
Yeah, it's kind of low on the battery, but...
And the rate 086 kilo, just fly heading 190.
Okay, so...
Well, we're...
Holding steady at 3,000 feet and
060, so We're about 27 miles out.
And got 120 knots airspeed and 125 ground speed, so we're actually going faster.
Going back. 24 northeast.
Yep.
Right.
There's our wind vector. So left to right wind.
November 550 Zulu Bravo, climb maintain 12,000.
Alright, so we got a wind coming from the left, pushing us.
Yep, we're heading into it. A little bit, little correction.
Trouble is at 47, fully approach altimeter is 3035.
You're having to do some rudder to the left.
So a little bit into the wind, a little correction.
November 2, November Juliet, you're about 12 miles from Woodstown, cross at 3,000, you're clear.
And we've got an airport right out here. That would be Brandywine Airport. Off to our left somewhere.
November 79er Juliet Sierra, fly heading 010, vector to final.
79 Juliet Sierra, heading 010, vector to final.
November 550 Zulu Bravo, contact Washington Center 132.05.
And we're coming up, sort of back the way, you know, we came.
And November 2, November Juliet, you can just cross Woodstown out above 2,100 for the approach.
So as we're flying,
4901, contact New York Center 124.62.
Constant back and forth with approach, making sure they know where we are and what we're doing.
We still 50 cents to 10,000.
79 Juliet Sierra, affirmative, 10,000.
Juliet Sierra is leaving 134.10,000.
Should give us a bit of a right turn.
The traffic will tell you.
But we got a little ways.
November 5286 Lima, contact Philly approach 123.8. Have a good day.
Over to Philly 123.8. You have a good day too, thanks. We'll check in with them now. Philadelphia approach, good afternoon, Cessna 5286 Lima, with you level 3000.
Cessna 5286 Lima, Philadelphia approach, thanks, proceed on course to Northeast Philadelphia.
On course, Northeast Philadelphia, 5286 Lima. So now he's giving me a direct.
Number 0 Whiskey Pop, and then I maintain 3000.
Which is a slight turn, about 20 degrees, and that's putting me directly on course to Northeast Philadelphia. Now they were using runway 24. Looks like we're basically going the opposite direction. We're heading about 6, a little bit to the right. So I'm going to guess they're going to give us a downwind entry for runway 24. Unlike the base entry that we had when we came. This one we're pretty much parallel to the runway. So it'll either be a left or right.
We're going to have King Air traps on the approach into runway 17 in Philadelphia. Climb to 3,500 so you can get beneath you at 2,500 or lower.
Roger that. 86 Lima climb at 3,500.
Thank you. 0 Whiskey Pop and send to maintain 2,500.
So we're all working together here. He wants me a little higher. Got a King Air coming out of Philly.
Skyline 6820 Papa request.
6820 Papa say request.
I'd like to do one turn and hold the Yardley and then do the VOR Alpha into Trenton. 682 Sierra Papa.
682 Sierra Papa, roger, maintain 3,000, clear to Yardley, hold as requested, advise once you want to do the VOR Alpha.
Maintain 3,000, hold as requested, we'll advise when you want to do the VOR Alpha. 682 Sierra Papa.
682 Sierra Papa, thanks, you are radar contact about 3 southwest of Yardley 26.
There we go, so there's our 3,500. We're still on course.
035, 682
Sierra Papa. Now we're going to level out.
70 Whiskey Papa, speed 170.
Back to 170 on speed, Whiskey Pop.
Philly, helicopter 603, Sierra Hotel.
0, Whiskey Papa, turn right heading 140, join the pod, join the localizer.
Back to 140, join the localizer, Whiskey Papa.
630 Hotel.
Yes, sir, out of Northeast Philly, VFR, climbing at 2500, just going to see if we get clearance into or through the Bravo, VFR down to the southwest.
Set off the tower information,
goal. 30 Hotel, squawk 0221.
0221.
0 Whiskey Pop, about 6 miles from Hile, maintain 2,500 till established, cleared ILS Zulu, runway 17 approach, 170 knots to Hile.
170 to Hile, 2,500 cleared to the ILS Zulu, 17.
All good?
0-3-0, yep. Hotels, radar contact off of northeast, 2,300, clear through Bob airspace, what altitude do you want to go to again?
I will stay at 25 if that'll work for you.
Yep, that'll work, 3-0 Hotel.
Thanks, sir.
3-0 Hotel, you can contact Philadelphia on 125.4.
25.4, switch, good day.
Good day.
And while I've got the time, I'll put in the tower frequency, so I'm ready to go. And the ground frequency. One less thing to do when I land. So, they say the most important two things in aviation are the next two things. Whatever coming up. So, yeah, we're good. We're 14 miles.
Tower on 118.5 with him.
Coming up in their airspace in a few minutes.
Come on.
And eventually he's going to switch us over to tower. Oh, again.
Yeah.
Oh, dear.
I think it's thermal.
It just got warm, you think?
Yeah, it's overheating.
700 Julia Sierra Philadelphia approach, northeast altimeter 3033, lower shortly.
So I'm hoping the one outside will be cool enough.
Reach 219 to descend and maintain 3000.
Descend and maintain 3000 for reach 219.
86 Lima, traffic no factor. You can start to descending your discretion for northeast Philadelphia, 12 o'clock at about 10 miles.
86 Lima, start a VFR descent. So we're going to start a very gentle descent, then at my discretion, so. Nothing crazy. Still got 10 miles, but we'll come down a little bit.
1,700 climbing to 126.47 to reach 209.
Thank you. 3180 Whiskey Ident, maintain 4,000.
Maintain 4,000.
I'm at about zero. About a 500 foot per minute descent.
Whiskey's radar contact, windfield 1900, Philadelphia altimeter 3034.
3034, 80 Whiskey.
It'll be a right downwind, I'm pretty sure.
Hey, so the wind is a little to our, a little behind us.
Direct Allentown, 80 Whiskey.
So that's going to push us a little to the right, right?
I'm going to pick up the weather.
Western Philly approach, Skyline 662, Sierra Papa request. Vectors, Foxtrot
2, Sierra Papa.
Standard regular circle.
Please return inbound, I'd like to start to
set up the URL there for you to press normal for instructor.
2, Sierra Papa, are you ready to do that now?
Initial contact,
yeah, it'll be another minute before we turn inbound.
Okay, I mean, this is the last turn, so once you turn inbound, then that's when you want to shoot the approach, is that correct?
Affirmative, 662, Sierra Papa.
Okay, 682 Sierra Papa, thanks for that. You're about 2 from yard. We crossed it out above 2,000, clear for the VOR Alpha approach, maintain VFR.
VOR Alpha approach, maintain VFR, 682 Sierra Papa.
Now to Julius Sierra, descend and maintain 3,000, the airport set your 11 o'clock at about 8 miles.
Now to Julius Sierra, descend and maintain 3,000, airport set your
7 out of Julius Sierra, cleavage approach 2-4, contact the northeast tower 126.9er.
7-9 Julius Sierra, cleavage approach 2-4 northerly, tower 126.9er.
Now you're constantly
thank
scanning here.
Traffic at 12 o'clock, 7 miles.
All right, give him a call. Yeah, 5286 Lima, I've got northeast Philly in sight.
5286 Lima, radar services terminated, squad 1200, contact the northeast tower 126.9er. We'll see you.
Over to tower and squawk at VFR. Thanks for your help. 5286 Lima.
You're welcome.
1200, over to tower. Northeast Philadelphia Tower, good afternoon. That's the 5286 Lima, 7 miles to the west of the airport inbound with Gulf full stop.
04 Tango Delta runway 24, clear for the option. Wind 230 at 8. Upon completion of your option, we'll make left close traffic.
24, clear for the option. Upon completion, left close. 04 Tango Delta.
That's the 5286 Lima Northeast Tower. And downwind. Enter right downwind runway 24, report midfield.
Right downwind 24, will report midfield, 5286 Lima. I was right.
And November 3063 Yankee Mako, right.
Here's our runway. Oh, I'm coming in at an angle to it, which is perfect. We're going to start our descent. Quick, make sure tanks are on both, make sure it's full rich. We got our landing light on, so that's good. That's a key point for my
for a 3 mile funnel.
Before landing check.
To your right, 3 miles of Cherokee. I'll indicate 1,700, making it right.
And I've got to come down to 1,100 feet. Boom, boom, boom.
We're 49 in Quebec, extending up wind on all crosswind.
Extending up wind 49 Quebec.
Good. Coming down. We're 11
out. Good afternoon, 6530 Charlie, send to the northwest.
I can see I'm going to come in and parallel that runway.
November 6530 Charlie, northeast tower. Enter right downwind 24.
1,200 for 1,100. Here we go. All right, we're going to arrest our descent, pull the nose up a little bit, try to hold that right about 1,100 feet there. Yep. We're not. Right, that looks good. And our airspeed is coming down. And we're approaching almost at a 45 degree angle, which is really what you want, how you want to approach the downwind leg of the traffic pattern. We're going to slowly start to come on over. See, if I start getting low, what I don't want to do is pull up. What I want to do is add a little power. That's going to arrest my descent.
You'll see traffic heading to your right, Cessna, and left downwind 24.
Traffic in sight and turning left downwind 49 Quebec.
49 Quebec, he's in on the right downwind, sorry.
With the traffic in sight, and it will be, I said, the right traffic pattern for 49 Quebec.
That was us.
49 Quebec, make left close traffic.
Left close traffic, 49 Quebec.
There's the runway?
Yeah.
We are, it's on our right, that's a right downwind.
That's 790 Julius here, runway 24, 1220
And we're going to report when we get halfway down the runway.
Runway 24.
Ah, nice. We're right where we want to be. Now we're flying our downwind leg parallel in the opposite direction of our landing.
We're going to do
two right turns.
Send the upwind, I'll call the crosswind turn.
Send the upwind, you'll call the crosswind. There's 49 Delta.
So
we're parallel to the runway.
Extend down, we number 2 following citation traffic, 2 mile final port traffic in sight.
86 Lima will extend the downwind, and yes, I've got traffic in sight.
Number 86 Lima, roger, number 2, runway 24, clear to land, wind 220 at 10.
Clear to land 24, number 2 for the field, 5286 Lima. All right, so he cleared us.
And November 3063.
After the guy, I see a guy out there.
Report the right track.
Someone already coming in.
Yep, there he is. He's
right
coming
there.
Down.
Okay.
Yep. So I can make my turn when he gets behind us. That's kind of the rule of thumb.
Gotcha.
3 or 4 Tango Delta. You have the traffic in the left downwind sight off your left wing.
Hey, from traffic in sight, 4 Tango Delta.
3 or 4 Tango Delta. Roger, follow that traffic.
Follow the traffic to our left.
So we're coming down to our beam the numbers opposite our touchdown point. At that point. This guy.
For 6530 Charlie, any chance I get a right base, 2-1.
Put my flap in, start my descent. He's behind, he's almost behind us.
Charlie, really negative, multiple aircraft in the pattern.
Not a problem, 6530 Charlie.
No, he's behind us, means I'm fine to do what I want.
Alright.
We'll start my right turn, start slowing it down. And slowly we're going to get into that white arc.
2549 Quebec, we're on left downwind runway 24.
Once I get to the white arc, I can start putting in flaps.
More flaps. Proceed direct to the numbers. Tighten it up here.
3060 Yankee.
November 2549 Quebec, spin down, I'll call base.
Staying on downwind 49 Quebec.
Citation 700 Julius Sierra, turn left taxiway Alpha ground point 7.
Julia, turn left alpha ground point 7.
86 Lima, turn time.
86 Lima, roger, clear to land. Caution, wait, turn.
86 Lima, roger. Alright. And there's our runway.
Yep.
We're going to manage our airspeed, our descent. And the lights are giving us 2 red and 2 right. We're right on the glide slope.
Midfield, left down.
Since he wants me to land kind of short, I'm going to drop all my flaps.
That'll
keep us away from that wake turbulence.
Continue to follow the traffic ahead, extend downwind, you'll call base.
Add a little power as we start to sink.
S-turns are approved for space, it looks like you might be catching them.
Alright, I'll make some S-turns, I see that for Tango Delta.
Our rudder keeps us on the center line, whoa! A little bit of wind.
Okay.
November 254, I'll get back. Traffic ahead and to your left in a mile is the Cherokee making a straight in from runway 24, up in the case 1100. Do you have it in sight?
I have it in sight, 49 Quebec.
Before I get back, Roger, number 2, follow that traffic, runway 24, cleared for the option, wind 22011.
Following that traffic, runway 24, clear for the option, 49 Quebec.
November 3063 Yankee, runway 24, clear for the option, wind 22011. Upon completion, make left, close traffic.
Clear for the option, 24, upon completion, left traffic, 30.
Well, that worked out.
I saw you did a few flares
three,
there.
3444 Quebec.
Kind of slow down
wind,
a little bit.
Yeah, start pulling me up.
Cessna 5286 Lima, turn right, taxiway. Correction, left, sorry about that. Left, taxiway, Juliet, ground, what's up?
Left on Juliet over to ground, 86 Lima.
All right. Cessna 44 Quebec, you set the immediate takeoff clearance?
Foxy Yankee, hold short of course.
Yeah, I noticed that trick. We're still going a little fast. You just pull it up a little bit.
Yep.
And just, you know, air brake and stall and...
Eventually.
North East Delaware ground, 5286 Lima is off 24 Julio. We'll be taxiing over to the city ramp.
386 Lima, North East ground, taxi via Golf, Alpha, Alpha 2, cross runway 33 at Golf.
Alright, 5286 Lima is Juliet Golf Alpha Alpha 2, crossing 33 at Golf.
Roger, 56 Yankee will be Cessna passing right to left on Golf. Behind him, you can continue Jackson.
Cessna passing right to left, we have traffic in sight on Golf. 456 Yankee.
Woohoo!
Now we're steering with the feet again.
Steer with the feet?
Steer with the feet.
And following instructions, so we're on Juliet, right on Golf, that's coming up.
So people don't realize it's not just air traffic control, it's also when you're on the runway, taxiing around.
Actually, most problems that people have are taxiing. They don't pay attention, or they don't follow the directions. Or they're not looking around outside. And one of the biggest things we worry about are what are called runway incursions. Putting an airplane or any vehicle onto a runway where it doesn't have permission to be there. This helps too, we've got smart taxi.
Smart taxi.
Yeah.
Yes, taxi.
So. We're on Gulf, he told me to cross 33, that's our other runway, and we're cleared to cross, but I'll let him know. So this guy's waiting for me, because he's coming to take off, so we'll give him a little quicker so he can get by. That good. It's a claim across 33 at Golf.
Right.
All right, so we're across this runway. Then he told me left on Alpha. That's this parallel runway. And back to where we started. Coming up on Alpha 2.
Northeast ground, FAA 09.
309 ground.
I'm at the glide slope. I need to go to the Mauser light lane, and I'll be in the RSA, but well off the runway.
309, roger, hold position. I'll get you out there when I can.
9, holding position at the glide slope.
A little tricky getting these airplanes where you want them exactly. Gotta kinda plan this in advance so you kinda know where to put it.
4443 Sierra Lima, Northeast clearance, cleared to Bravo November Alpha Airport. Fly runway heading. Expect radar vector.
Okay, we'll do a quick shutdown.
Maintain 2000, expect flight level 400, 10 minutes after departure.
Do a ground check.
123.8, squawk 1565.
Shutdown.
That's it. Ha! She wrote.
Thanks, Howard. Thanks, that was...
It was a pleasure.
That was amazing. It was,
Glad you enjoyed it. as you probably saw, there's a lot going on.
A lot, yeah. It was a constant with two different air traffic control centers in Wilmington and Philadelphia. And we were in Wilmington, Delaware for like 2 seconds, like
and
on the ground.
Back here. Right, there's a lot of coordination with communication. I think one thing that people need to understand if they're interested in flying is manipulating the controls. That's only one part of it. We have a lot of work to do in terms of navigating and communicating and planning, you know, where we're going to go and how we're going to get there safely. So the air traffic control works with us. And that's the same air traffic control that's talking to the big airplanes landing at Philadelphia International. We all work together. Obviously, they're going to keep me out of their way. They're not going to move the big airplanes away from my little airplane. But we all share the same airspace, and if you do what you're told and communicate well, it works really, you know, works out really well.
Yeah, I heard them talking to you, and then talking to jets, and everything. It was just the whole thing going around.
Yeah, we're all in the same airspace, but there's plenty of room up there if you kind of do what you're told and know the rules.
There were some points in there where I saw you were flying the plane and also feeding in the new
right.
information for the flight plan when we were changing
right.
from direction and also changing the radio.
So, yeah, multitasking.
Yeah.
So a lot of people, when they think about multitasking, what they really are talking about is not multitasking, but doing a lot of tasks one after another. When you're flying, you are multitasking. You're talking on the radio. You are putting in different, you know, frequencies, as you said, or changing your courses, changing, you know, settings on various instruments, and you're flying the airplane all at the same time. And that's a skill that you have to develop because you don't have the luxury of sort of pushing the pause button and stopping. You have to, you're constantly moving. And
there's time, significant time pressure with all this stuff.
Absolutely. One of the reasons we use a simulator, so we can simulate these conditions and learn to do many things at the same time.
Right, because when you're approaching the airport and you have to do all these tasks, it's
yep.
not like you can just postpone it or just, you know, stop and wait a while. I mean, you're in the air, you have a desk, you know, you're going to be arriving at the airport at a very specific time and yada yada. So.
Right, so one of the phrases we use is not getting behind the airplane, which means that the airplane is already out there, but you're still back there working on something. You always want to be ahead of the airplane, thinking about what's next. One of the points you remember, we were flying in between Wilmington and Philadelphia. We had a couple of minutes when nothing really was happening, so I could set the radios up that I'll need later. And that's the kind of planning that we want to do to make sure that you know, you're efficient in how you accomplish all these tasks.
That's what I was noticing, that you were being very efficient with your time. There was no wasted time.
No wasted time.
And when you had some time, you were doing other things. You know, that, like you said, I don't have to do this when we get on the ground if I do it now.
Do it now. And, you know, that's how we want to be thinking. That's how we train our students to be very efficient. And but flying is busy.
like, you know, especially when you're flying in, you know, some of the busiest airspace in the world here, and, you know, you're just staying constantly engaged, which is, frankly, why I enjoy it so much.
And one of the things I didn't point out, but it's interesting, is there's two different electrical systems, like two different magnetos, and there's, like, two different ignition systems.
So, there are two magnetos. The magnetos are basically they're generators. They're spinning and they're providing the electricity to fire the spark plugs. And they're self-sustaining. So as the engine turns, the magnetos turn, and they keep firing the engine. If we were to lose our entire electrical system, that wouldn't affect the engine turning at all. Two of them, just for redundancy and efficiency, and we check to make sure they're both working. But if we lose one, the other one's still working and we can still be safe.
And there's two separate redundant ignition systems on the engine.
Well, sure. There are two spark plugs in each cylinder, and they're alternately firing. So it's a lot of redundancy, backup instruments, and I keep an iPad with me as a backup instrument. We have two radios, so yes, a lot of redundancy.
Thanks, Howard. This is great.
Maybe, let's do it again.
Yeah, I'd love to do it again sometime. So thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
And, you know, they thank you too. Bye!
That's where I work. Berserk in my lab. It's where I work. Yeah.